communism after 1989 is a lucid analysis of the tradition of working class movements of actual existing socialisms in the 20th century and of the political and cultural history of Eastern and Central Europe after 1989, as well as an intervention into theories of class struggle, nationalism, ethnicism, fascism, and so on. Regarding today's discussion, my idea was to center it on a phenomenon that I find to be theoretically crucial as well as politically urgent, that is post-fascism. Post-fascism is a curious neologism coined by our guest in order to denote the present-day state of political affairs. So for those of you who are not familiar with this term, we will do our best to dissect it during the discussion. So I would now proceed to the first question. So as I've already mentioned, in order to describe the predominant contemporary practices, ideologies and policies, you coined the term post-fascism. So what is post-fascism? On the one hand, this prefix post implies that there is a certain discontinuity between historical fascisms of the 20th century and the present-day form of fascism, but this preservation of the noun fascism also implies a continuity. So my sub-question would be, what are the main differences and the main similarities between historical fascisms and what you call post-fascism?
Well, first let's be clear about what you mean by phenomena of today. This essay has been published 17 years ago, in the year 2000. So it could have not dealt with the real phenomena of today really bothering many of us. But and also a little precision on that Green Left Party thing that lasted just a month. And it's on Wikipedia and I can't get rid of it somehow. You know, they asked me to be their candidate on the European elections and I helped them to make a stand. The party disappeared 3 months later. The whole thing is just insignificant episode. So don't think that I was some kind of party leader. No. But going back to your question, you see, one of the main structural elements of fascist societies and fascist bourgeois of the state was always a an innovation. Compared to the Enlightenment idea of political participation and of citizenship. Citizenship in the main theoretical, or if you wish, utopian form of the Enlightenment was considered to be a universal condition. Whoever is a human person ought to be, at least, ought to be, we know they weren't, but ought to be also a citizen. Part of the human condition is the civic condition. No human person can live without a political dimension. To the extent we are social beings, we have to have a participatory and egalitarian quality within organized society. That's the Enlightenment utopia. Now, this has been, of course, as you know, directly contradicted by imperialism, and within the nation state, that's a new development, by national socialism and its cognates. I won't go into the details known to you from history. Most, in classical fascism and Nazism, most criteria according to which the human condition has been divorced from the political condition, the civic condition, was racial, thereby implying too that even the human condition wasn't truly universal. because National Socialism, and especially other fascist versions less, has emphasized that people, non-members of the Indo-European Aryan race, are not quite as human as the rest, and there was a hierarchy in human excellence and virtue among the various races, you know, the Nordic race being on top and so on, downwards. And so you see, therefore, it is quite clear that once you divorce the civic condition from the human condition, also the human condition unravels, and a hierarchy that is considered to be preternatural, quasi-natural, quasi-biological, what have you, in our own day is considered to be cultural, but it belongs to the same, I'll tell you why, it comes back to the same, and therefore it is a radical affirmation of inequality, not as a legal imposition of political order, but as a fundamental condition of human coexistence. That's how it was stipulated by fascists. And a parenthesis about culture versus race. People say that there's a great difference. The hell is a great difference, because what is important here are inherited, unchangeable, permanent specifics of a human group. When people today say, for the best known example, that, Muslim people and Islamicists have a specific cast of mind that opposes them to liberal democracy and to God knows, you know, to microbiology and geometry, I don't know. And also you read those, this time not by the professional right, but say by liberals, that say Russians, because of their culture of tyranny, of multi-secular tyranny, they have developed these properties of what, servility and love of tyranny and other nonsense of this kind. So the thing is that permanent traits of a human group that are stipulated as really permanent and unchangeable, that you have to reckon with as a static determination of a human group, well, that's fascist. Whether it is racist or ethnicist or culturalist or whatever, you know, structurally is the same. That's one thing in which the identities or similarities or whatever can be emphasized in a simplified way, but yes. You don't need, because that's the basic trait of fascism, that's not discrimination, that's not injustice, that's not a bad sort of constitutional order, that's a model of human coexistence based on this permanence of group traits, stipulated, dictated, imposed, whatever. To impose this, i.e. to impose servitude on human groups of your choice, you don't need necessarily an extremely statist order, as it was the case, of course, in the 20s and the 30s, which was the time of an economic cycle in which state interference after a certain crisis had become natural. Also, it's quite clear that in 33, after the Great Crisis, Hitler was a statist, when 22, Mussolini was a free trader and a balanced budgeter, and in economics a neoliberal, avant la lettre, and later not. And so, for example, these old theories about fascism, that these are based on an exacerbation of state functions, and that's nonsense. There are fascisms that are not like that at all. That's one thing. Second, you don't need necessarily a destruction of the parliamentary system and other accoutrements of outward accoutrements of modern liberal capitalist states. You don't have to get rid of all of those, of some, yes, in order to impose such an order, to step over the constitutional order, and to realize sovereignty as the power to determine who belongs to the political community, the relevant political community, who is a member, who is a citizen. Now, any enlightenment leader, any democrat, if you wish, I don't use usually the word democratic because it's so misleading, any kind of democratic order, egalitarian order, and all enlightenment orders have to be egalitarian, there's no other, legally at least, can be suppressed very simply because you see the modern capitalist state is always a nation state and the universal condition of citizenship cannot be realized without actually the destruction of the capitalist nation state, hence of the capitalist state as such. So even the Enlightenment utopia cannot fully realized in capitalism. That has been quite clear to a number of people, beginning with Jean-Jacques Rousseau. And so it's not a new idea. And you see, I used in this essay Georges Bataille, if you remember. Georges Bataille, apart from his other merits and sins, has understood very profoundly, I think, that one of the essential aspects of capitalist society is this differentiation between the homogeneous and the heterogeneous, and the heterogeneous element, the superfluous, the plus, the more that is unnecessary in a rationalizable way cannot be established in the usual symmetries of modern societies. That is more than that, and that is considered always either irrational, like in religion, or utopian, as in ideas of freedom, or foreign, or racial and culturally foreign in sense of human communities. And so is luxury, so is ecstasy, so is pleasure, whatever is more than this symmetrical world of equations on which capitalist rationality is based. Now the obliteration and the suppression of heterogeneity in this sense of Bataille is the aim, is the real deep aim of fascism, and we still have that. When banal politicians of today would say, we don't want anybody within our borders who is not a citizen, for whose citizenship, in other words, we didn't give our agreement, our approval, so we will define who will be a citizen. It is in the power of the sovereign to decide about the exception, you know, as you know, but citizenship is not an exception. It ought to be a universal condition. And it's made into an exception, made into a favor, bestowed on people by our governments, all of them mostly, that haven't really gone beyond this extreme conceptual frontier of fascism. None of them. None of them. And the refugee crisis that didn't exist when I first wrote this essay, it's unfortunately a proof how these things function. Okay.
Thank you. You also mentioned on several occasions that ethnicism is basically one of the crucial components of post-fascism, and in the article, The Meaning of the Refugee Crisis, this article was, I think, translated a year ago and in Latina, you argue there that the rise of ethnicism was conditioned by the end of traditional working class politics, as well as with the end of this universalist version of non-exclusive nationalism. So I would like to talk now about these two categories, class and nation. So first, about class. You write about this in your article or in your essay, also translated here, The Truth About Class. So how do you conceive the category of the working class, and how does your conception differ from traditional conceptions which were predominant in the socialist or social democratic movements of the 20th century?
Well, it differs and it doesn't. So it's I'm not, this is of course a further thinking about the topic. It's not first of all polemics, but also, you know, the benefit of hindsight after the demise of the international workers' movement, not working class politics as such, but the workers' movement, of the international workers' movement. After its demise, we can see some things more clearly than we could before. You see, there are languages, including the English, in which the existence of the working class and working class politics are the same. The word labor means, you know, what does labor do? That means that what do the working class movements do? Trade unions, the Labour Party, the Communist Party, etc. So that's what labour means in English. It was a very useful word. It's expressed also a reality when indeed the corporate and collective political identity of the working class has been the socialist one. And, well, there were other ones, but this was the main thing, and it was identical with it. And indeed, to this very day, and I don't regret to say it, a socialism that doesn't contain at its center or near its center the emancipation of the working class is not socialist. It cannot be, and because of structural givens, not necessarily of our leftish sentimentality, which I share, but that's not so important. And what is important, though, is the fact that the greatest cleavage still among people in a capitalist society is between owners and non-owners of capital. As Alfred Sohn Redl says in a famous letter to Adorno in God knows 35, I think, he says that you cannot, dear Teddy, you cannot change the fact that some people live in order to work for others, and some people live benefiting from the work of others. That has not changed, and that's not likely to change until capitalism exists. The way in which this exists, yes, obviously, it's constantly changing. But the main structural and at the same time moral fact that it is, of course, alien labor, and in the case of capitalism, free labor, that that determines our society. In other terms, you are not obliged to work for a capital owner, and you know, in capitalism, class means both servitude and freedom. It is freedom, because what is freedom in a modern society? It's the freedom of contract. You make a deal, a sort of a deal, a contract agreement with somebody, and that is the main case that is constituting duties. You agree to the performance of obligations. That's what the word contract is like. In exchange of a salary, you oblige yourself to do this and that and the other boring things. And, you know, but that's freedom. You're not obliged, like in ancient Egypt, you know, to work. You know, if not, then you would be punished, killed, whatever, displaced and so on. That's only an exceptional case, but it was a widespread case, of course, in the colonies. But still, the main case of capitalism is free labor. That is, of course, as we know from Rosa Luxemburg too, of course, that has been always supplemented and could not be independent of slave-like and unfree labor, but let me now be more abstract. And so that has to do something with the idea of freedom in a capitalist society, freedom of contract. And at the same time, of course, because people without capital cannot survive without agreeing to work. That's also a question of servitude, with which go not only obligations assumed, more or less, usually less freely, in exchange of obligations that are alien to your own aims and aspirations and so on and so forth, but also other things. For example, one of the most important thing in this is the differentiation between mental and physical labor, spiritual and physical labor. That is not only a question of creature comforts and such things, but also a question of very deep ideas, very profound ideas of hierarchy. All caste and class societies have put at the pinnacle of the hierarchy of values the spirit. That was the base of the caste system. Priesthood was the highest caste. Then, of course, were the nobles, you know, who embodied the fiery soul, the fighting, you know, warrior spirit, the virtues of which were, of course, bravery and self-sacrifice in military, knightly, chivalresque sense, etc. And then there were the tradesmen and the servants and so on, and the women. And all those people associated symbolically to the body, and to the body subordinated to travail. Travail is a French word in English, and it means pain, it means work, and it means labor. It means bringing children to this world. Also labor, no? Travail, from travail. Yeah. It means always pain, of course, like rabota in Russian. It means always pain. It is humiliating, it is painful, and it is shameful. And this remains the case also in capitalist society. This is not limited to caste society. It's less radical, less obvious, it is hidden. But still, look at any town. What is in the main square? The church and the city hall. No? It's very simple, really. I mean, we are surrounded by the symbolism of spiritual superiority and of hierarchical power. Now it is socialism and political socialism that has reversed this and has put the pinnacle at the pinnacle of the hierarchy of values, the worker. You know, the Yahoo who works with his hands, the person who has been despised for millennia and millennia and millennia. Now it is difficult even to realize what an innovation this was. What a whole reversal of values this was. And which went, of course, together with all the other re-evaluations of values. If not the spirit is up and the body down, well, that means, of course, reversal of everything. That means that children are not less valuable than adults. Women are not less valuable than men. Menial work is not more despicable than scientific research. Power doesn't confer dignity, etc. And this goes together with a recognition, of the dual nature of labor in a capitalist society. And which is, of course, the work of Marx. And so now that the political and corporate identity of the working class, owing to the well-known factors, has more or less ceased to exist, we should remember that the structural and historical and epistemological constants of proletarian existence have not changed one iota. Nothing. So in this I'm not so much innovating as being orthodox. And the question is, of course, always, which I can't answer, if you can, please tell me, how a new such emancipatory and liberating corporate identity can be established. Or established again, I mean, anew or whatever. because that's not clear, not clear to me either. But this, and just one sentence more, and this of course explains that the pressure of socialism, labor, communism, what have you, which is the latest edition of universalism, and of course much stronger than any universalist religion that of course existed before, and philosophy like the Stoics, and stronger because of course first it's this worldly, and second because it's really universal, because it's referring to aspects that old religion didn't refer to. When this political pressure ceases, inspiration ceased, nationalism that has been partly a response to socialism, modern nationalism, in the form that it took in the First World War, say, it's not necessary. Nationalism was itself a universalist doctrine. It said, those of you who live in my nation state and are ready to assimilate, to make your own my patriotic views, to identify with the national community in order to make yourself national citizens like any other, at least in your interior, okay, then you can. The price of admission is national, assuming of national identity. All minorities, all heterogeneous elements, all unwilling people, all disobedience, all women, etc., 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 all religious people who didn't agree with the main tenets, etc., etc., can be full members if they declare themselves good Hungarians, good Germans, good this, and indeed will obey, will go to the army, will pay the taxes, will indeed be regimented in this way. And but after the demise of socialism, you don't need this anymore. So ethnicists of today can declare it simply that we just don't want to live together with this minority or the other, this foreign population or the other. Our way is either secession or the exclusion of minorities, exclusion of the other. You just go to hell. How will you survive? It's not my concern, because you are not any longer as human as I am. Why? I won't explain. You just aren't. That's it. This is what we, this is ethnicism. It's not nationalism. It's not Mazzini. It's not Kossuth. Yeah. That's nothing to do with it. That was, of course, liberating nations from foreign domination, you know, identifying citizenship with being a citizen, you know, not being subordinate to some foreign monarch or whatever. Very well. Already the decomposition of Yugoslavia is a mixed case. It has nationalist and ethnicist elements, both. And it started as this kind of independence movement, for, and then of course in 2 seconds it has been shown that it was the exclusionist phenomenon that was directed more to indigenous minorities than to than against neighboring rivals, national rivals, or at least as much. Yeah. Anyway, and you see something that is not in my essays. The following thing is if you think that, I wrote to this to you in my letter, if nationalism is the thesis and the communist revolution in 17 and subsequent years is the antithesis, the synthesis is fascism. Fascists have understood that a universalist opposition to socialism is impossible, and that a restoration of hierarchy, not on the basis of spirit that's gone, that has been stolen by Enlightenment, by Kant, etc., Hegel, that's not any longer available. I'm speaking metaphorically. And so an other notion of nature is needed. That the terrain was prepared by social Darwinism, and as we know, the first social Darwinist was Darwin, and he was a very good pre-fascist, and others, and So evolutionary biology and genetics and all that serve as a basis, as a pseudo-scientific basis, for saying that fascism may contradict the moral intuitions of Christian Europe, but is based on reality. Just listen. What are today's post-fascists telling you? That all this unreal, illusionary political correctness and progressivism and blah, blah, are artificial. We represent reality. We represent nature. We represent the recognition of force, of rivality between races, between ethnies, between people, and so on and so forth. Because that is what they regard as natural, something that is underneath or above an egalitarian political community, that it is liberal and like reform anyway it was in Ethiopia, and which is the lived experience, at least as an aim, as an objective, of the workers' movement. So, you know, so I think that the very otherwise very suspicious German historian, Ernst Nolte, has a point when he says that Nazi revolution was directed against communism. But of course it was directed against communism. Well, you know, I mean, just read Hitler. You just don't read the great Holocaust histories, but read Hitler himself. He knew. He knew what he was doing. And that's one thing. And that it was partly a preemptive counter-revolution. And just think about it. Fascists, because, you know, the story of the Second World War and the Soviet Union hides from our eyes that on the European continent, all communist and socialist revolutions have been defeated by fascism. 22 Italy, 34 Austria, 33 Germany, 36 Spain, and Portugal, etc., etc., semi-fascist systems in Poland and Bulgaria and Hungary and Romania and so on and so forth. By 1940, every socialist movement on the European continent has been defeated by fascism. Fascism was victorious. European socialism didn't revive on its own, but it was made possible for a while by the military victory of three extra-European powers, United States, Britain, and Russia. In Europe, fascism was and remains victorious. Yes.
So nationalism also basically withered away and was replaced by ethnicism. So
yes.
I would just like if you could elaborate a bit more on ethnicism, and particularly I'm interested in whether you perceive ethnicism really as a radical break from nationalism, or is it rather that nationalism itself, you know, carries in itself the seeds of ethnicism, as it were?
Yes, well, you know, of course, history is always complicated, and of course, there are always uncertain boundaries. And yes, there have been, in various circumstances, especially in the case of stateless peoples, there have been some elements maybe pointing towards ethnicism. But I don't think this is so important. It's true, yes, of course. And sociological Begriffsbildung, you know, sociological formation of concepts is always difficult because you deal with abstractions and with empirical things as well. But on the whole, what's the difference? Nationalism is part of the revolutionary phase of bourgeois politics. It has a very strong anti-monarchic component. It goes against empire, of all kinds of empire, from within and against, you know, world empires as they existed. The idea of self-determination is a democratic idea and it's linked to nationalism. And also, nationalism was always an ally of liberalism and democratism in the 19th century. It had a liberationist and emancipatory content and went usually with the liberation of agrarian populations. It went against serfdom, as you know, in Eastern Europe and so on and so forth. So it had this political dimension, but of course national is always dangerous, is always inflaming collective passions that have led to bloodshed. But you can't say that it wasn't strongly political, in the classical sense, a strongly political movement. Ethnicism, which is not an ideology that declares itself as a description from outside. Nationalists were proud nationalists. Ethnicists, I'm not saying that they're ethnicists, I'm saying about that they are. That they are. And what do they want? And what do they say? They're quite sincere, but they can permit themselves to be quite sincere these days. They would say that the state, the relationship to which constitutes the quality of a citizen, of various kinds of citizens, is irrelevant or secondary. The primary group, the belonging to which constitutes the core of ethnic politics, is ethnic. It's racial or linguistic or cultural, usually all of these, and it's blurred in order to make commissions. But basically, it's non-civic and its dominant form is cultural. And linguistic, but cultural mostly. And it can be, of course, characterized as religious terms or whatever, you know, from open your daily newspaper. And so the difference between belonging to the core group and being a citizen of a given state has undermined the egalitarian traits of existing liberal democratic societies, as feeble, as enfeebled as they were anyway already. And this is recognized as the birthright of the ethnic elites, avant-gardes, leading groups, whatever. I'll use the word the Pyrenees. You don't know who the Pyrenees are. There was in Hungary an opinion poll where people were asked what did they think about Romanians, Serbs, etc., etc. And the poll says invented a non-existent ethnic group, the Pyrenees, the Pyrenees. And 59% of Hungarians hated them very much indeed. And you know, it's really the Serbs are okay, but the Pyrenees with us too. The Serbs are more popular actually. The Romanians less, but the Serbs have done better than the Pyrenees. And so when the Pyrenean leader declares himself, it's always him. That everybody in the Pyrenean Republic has to be a good Pyrenean, or otherwise it has no place in our proud nation. And they mean it. And here there's a double strategy. One is a call to obedience. Okay, conformism, what have you. And second, introducing a non-constitutional dividing line between citizens that is not legally ever recognized, but which is, of course, politically imposed, and which prepares the ground for the loss of those political liberties that were fully compatible with classical nationalism. And, for example, classical nationalism is fully compatible with minority rights. There's no conceptual or logical impediment that would, well, in practice, of course, they were never very much protected of minorities, but there's no logical reason why they should be so. And indeed there have been some nations in which positive minority politics exist, but these are not the largest and most important nations. But that meant that they have disregarded the ethnic difference. France was, of course, the main example. Être français, That meant that you have a French passport. And of course, that meant lots of things, how you have to behave, and etc., etc., etc. But you weren't examined. Where you're coming, what's your religion, etc., etc. And now you are. And that's a major step back. And of course, one of the signs, there are many, of the decomposition of the contemporary order of late capitalism. So ethnicism is, in this sense, of course, a decadent, if you wish, state of affairs that obtains in present-day capitalist societies. Nevertheless, that doesn't mean, of course, that it's not dangerous. You know, that's only the fascists who think that the decadent are few. They themselves were decadent and they were not few. And but there's a great force in this, because of course you see all the universalist ideologies, not only socialism and enlightenment, but also Christianity is not there, and nationalism is not there, and old-style liberalism is not there. All these things are in the deepest crisis, or they're disappearing altogether. And ethnicism is, you know, a political practice more than a political ideology that is quite in tune with these developments.
There's also an article, the 200 Years War, which is a sort of a case study of rise of ethnicism in countries of former Yugoslavia. So I was thinking if you could briefly sum up your argument about how specific geographical and historical circumstances contributed to the rise of ethnicism in our region.
Well, provided I still remember that essay, it was written long ago, but if I'm not very much mistaken, I'm not a scholar of myself, you know, of course there is a specific point about national and ethnic and civic and political feelings in slightly subordinate or less subordinate nations of empires. Now, you see the origins of national ethnic politics in this region, of course, have their roots in the realities of the Austro-Hungarian monarchy and of others, also to a certain extent of Hohenzollern and of the Ottoman, but mostly the Austro-Hungarian monarchy, that was the model. And this is why, for example, it was very characteristically two socialists from the Austro-Hungarian monarchy, Rosa Luxemburg and Otto Bauer, who formulated two versions, and Lenin was of course the third, but he was not from here, of how to solve the national question. Rosa Luxemburg, well, I'll simplify. Rosa Luxemburg said, don't solve it. The revolution will take care of it. And the subordinate element of nationhood, ethnicity, language and culture will solve itself. Let's don't go to people with slogans of autonomy and independence. You'll just detract from the central zeal, etc., the radical workers' movement. It hasn't been never tried, so we don't know. Interestingly, Lenin proposed something else, as you know, and was extremely successful for a moment for that, because it's one of the reasons why the October Revolution has won. Because he said to everybody, and that is again forgotten, it was greeted with ecstasy by hundreds of millions of people in the whole world, namely, do you want to be independent? Go! Go! You want your own state? Go! You don't want to stay within Russia? You're free to go. Everybody forms their own communities as they like. You know, that's a fantastic idea. And, you know, totally wonderful, revolutionary, destructive idea. Smashing the state more effectively than anything else. You know, quite apart from, you know, publishing the secret documents, dispensing with diplomacy, you know, dissolving police, dissolving the professional army, not believing in government, etc., etc. these were just decorations, as it were, politically, on the body of Soviet Russia, saying to everybody, you don't have to stay within a state you don't like. Huh, what an idea. And, yeah, and, but of course, nothing came of it, well, little. Well, you know, one of the results was Piłsudski's Poland, thank you. And, but you see, but what the Soviet Union did and what the other socialist federative commonwealth did was to realize Otto Bauer's program of combination of territorial, cultural and personal autonomy. This is what the good old Austrian social democrat Josip Broz Tito was trying to do. And this is also what the old, reliable Austrian social democrat Clement Gottwald was trying to do, and so on and so forth. And what did this mean? That nationhood was a universalist composite, Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia, etc. And subnational, cultural and local autonomy was recognized. And I'm speaking for autonomy also in the case of federative republics, that's a specific Yugoslav differentiation that makes no sense whatsoever. And it's just legal, not real. And you see, that has meant already that the important political identity that's really counted in the heads of Kardel, Tito and the rest, was, you know, basically a non-national commonwealth of the working class that had its own local traditions, regional traditions, or whatever, but basically it was emancipated from all these ties, etc. And let everybody to live their cultural identities because, you know, and varietas delicta. And so, you know, already ethnicity was sub-political in Yugoslavia and in Czechoslovakia too, and the Soviet Union too, of course. These were the great federations. So therefore, when it broke up, because the universalist tie that tied it together didn't obtain any longer, because that tie was called the Communist Party. That was the primary political organization, and that was universalist and federal. It wasn't local, it wasn't ethnic, etc., etc. And when they permitted in 60, how many? The federalization of the communist...
74.
League. Sorry, yeah. Yeah, even better, 74, thank you. Well, that was the beginning of the end. How can you have a communist party that is ethnic and not communist? I mean, that's, then you don't, right? And so when the Communist Party was not any longer the integrating element, and there was also there was another sign in 81 in Poland when the party threw out their hands and called the army to solve the crisis. It couldn't solve it itself. Right. And a military coup in a communist state. That's not communist. And not even in Stalin's sense. Follow my meaning. And, you know, so therefore, Yugoslavia, etc., were prepared by this specific situation for this. And this is why the leaders of the new post-Yugoslav republics, so they're anything but not republics, and, well, in the traditional sense, they say, we don't want to live together with X, Y, and Z. Because they're not us. That's not nationalism. That's not nationalism. Nationalism always had abstract ideas of freedom of their own. Maybe not ideas I share, but some. But you know, I won't live together with people who rise and say, you know. What is that? In traditional political terms, that's nonsense. But it's not nonsense in the new sense, in which the universal way that prepares you for being able to live together, people showing up other cultural characteristics, it's perfectly adequate. This was, you know, the decomposition of Yugoslavia is the model of contemporary world politics. That was the first real radical case, especially Bosnia and Kosovo, and they have shown how things will be as follows. And they are, that's it. And this is exactly the same logic as the logic of the refugee crisis. Does anybody say that the refugees are bad as such? No, it's just not us. And that is sufficient. And that is sufficient. It has not been sufficient since the days of Saint Augustine. So that's a difference, okay? And so it's worth at least to be writing an article about it.
For one more question, and then also include the public into the debate.
Yes.
So, my last question would be the eternally recurring one: what is to be done, particularly what is to be done about ethnicism, post-fascism, because it seems that. Left, when it's faced with the widespread resentment against migration or with the rise of the so-called populist right, is caught in between two positions. You have, on the one hand, some appeals to abstract universalism of, say, human rights, or here we have liberals like to appeal to Europe supposedly standing for Western values of the Western civilization as such.
Of the pale face.
Yeah. But on the other hand, you have, I think, equally hopeless appeals to multiculturalism, which preaches the respect for other cultures, but basically accepts rather than tackles the ethnicist belief or ethnicist presupposition that society is differentiated into different cultures, which are some understood as like hermetically sealed entities. So my question would be, is there a third way or a progressive path beyond these two deadlines?
Dead ends, rather, yes. Well, one thing, you may know that I refuse the use of this term populist. I wrote this article in Open Democracy. It's called The Mystery of Populism Finally Unveiled. It is unveiled, yes. There isn't such a thing. That's its mystery. And it stands for many things, and it's just really misleading. First, let's dispose of one thing that there have been some people on the left who were experimenting against ethnicism and such, for reinventing nationalism in a democratic way. That's in abstract, it's not a bad idea, but it doesn't seem to be particularly successful, and it has been swallowed up by other phenomena and developments, so it didn't lead anywhere. There was called anti-globalism or whatever. That was, of course, a version of universalist nationalism of the left, and it seems to have been dissolved by now. The term exists, but it doesn't really exist as a political reality any longer. Now, especially as indeed none other but Karl Mannheim has discovered so long ago, first in an article in 29 and then in a book in 35, this rhythmic, cyclical variations between free trade and protectionist phases of modern capitalism. And it's nothing new. And of course, in this protectionist phase, presented by globalism, not logically but emotionally, understandably, has been dented. But that's a side issue. What seems to me important here? Well, first, there is some unachieved and unfinished work to be done that has not been done by revolution. I mean our revolution, communist revolution. It hasn't been done. And quite apart from its defeat and its deterioration and its corruption and what have you. And that is the abandonment of one of the most essential core messages of the October Revolution, which is, of course, the continuation, radicalization of the idea of peace. Of peace. Of a world without organized and legitimate coercion. In other words, a world unlike Kant's world, in which well-organized republics are able to achieve eternal peace. The world without states. So the link between internationalism and Marxian libertarianism has been neglected. Well, obviously, it was. I don't have to recapitulate the history of the Bolshevik Party, known to you. But this has been neglected and forgotten. It has been taken out. This is what was meant by the bloody red flag, okay? And by the red star with the five continents. Nation-states, the world without hierarchy. So, well, constituted by nation-states, of course, will have to obey the strongest and will finally be defeated even as nation-states by imperial systems. And this has been, and you know, this housework has not been done. And this is really, must inspire you, because this is the most unpopular, most hopeless, most utopian, most impossible undertakings, so worth doing. In other words, because only those things are worthy. But at first appear as abominations. Those are the good things. And, you know, it appears as abomination for a very simple reason. That in the last times, because we live in a deeply conservative era, everything that is not compatible with hopelessness and pessimism is felt to be unreal. That's very, very interesting. You know, so what do conservatives tell you? You want a world in which unselfish moral patterns prevail, with people with their sexual passions, with their acquisitiveness, etc., etc. The nervous rerum gerendarum, you know, the tires for manila. But people are just sinners. You know, the whole conservative theory is based on the origin of sin theory. People are bad, so you should not expect any essential improvements. And this is very largely accepted. And it seems not to this august audience, but to many people, it seems that this is really human nature. This is really how things are. And, you know, look at everybody. Everybody's becoming a racist. You know these talks. Probably I'm doing it sometimes, me too. Yeah, well, one has darker moments. But, of course, who doesn't? But, I certainly do. And, but that, an unachieved task of world history, an unfinished business of the revolution that will have to be made in order to humankind to be what it should be. And, you know, so yes, so what I'm proposing, you know, a better version of the October Revolution. Of course, that's the way. And it shouldn't be, the conditions are different. But why am I calling it at all a new version of the October Revolution? Because the October Revolution had the idea. Cannot pretend that it hadn't. You know very well the old Latin saying, corruptio optimi pessima, you know, the corruption of the best is the worst. Yes, it was pretty awful, as we all know. But that has happened to a number of things, as you know. And I, you know, chemistry has made cyclone B gas possible. Doesn't mean that the chemistry is not a good idea. And so this is an unachieved business and it has to be finished. And so I think that in this very bad moment, in this very deeply conservative consensus reading everywhere, generalized hopelessness, this very low view, this very
very low view of our fellow human beings. Really underserved. To this extent, I mean, really underserved. And we're not all just selfish. Creature of our instincts and prejudices. That's totally plausible. And so this has to be revived, and that this is why I'm preaching nowadays, of course, you know, latest in this political critique thing, that we have to return to politics and forget the idea that all power corrupts. No. The power of everybody doesn't. And that's what we should aim at, and there's no reason why we shouldn't try. And we won't get votes for that. But elections are not organized by people who don't want power. And we don't. So, power is a tool and whereby things can be achieved. How do you keep that tool clean? Well, that's a moral task. And moral tasks are individual. There I have no advice because I'm no priest.
Thank you. I think it's now time to include the public into the debate.
You know, there's a Hungarian saying, I have choked a hole in your belly. The pleasure to be here and have a book published was too strong for me, so maybe I talk too much. But please.